Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. Today I want to share some products that I'm just not gonna use this year or not worry too much about. Last year I was very much like, oh my god, I need to use this if I want this result or I need to use that because my skin needs this. I feel like what became a usually relaxing time for me very much became a kind of like, right, what day am I doing this? What day am I using this acid or exfoliant or active rather than just like chilling the fuck out, you know? So I'm gonna share five products that I'm no longer going to use, not going to try and use anymore, and not worry too much about. Not because I think they're shit, but I just don't, for me personally, really need to use these. I think it might be interesting. I don't know. Let's start off with the products I surprisingly probably get asked about a lot, and that's actually facial oils. I feel like not a lot of people, when it comes to like the skincare community, really talk about oils as a category in their own that much, or I'm not just paying attention. But there's quite a few reasons as to why I just don't like using oils on my face. For me, they are just kind of pointless. They're also a product that I feel a lot of people don't truly understand what they do or where they belong in the skincare routine. And even if you just look on TikTok, you see a lot of people using them in odd places. A lot of brands market their oils as serums now or elixirs and tell you to use them in the serum stage, which kind of isn't really the point. Like a product that is literally five oils all mixed together isn't really a serum in my books. It's not really going to have the positive effects that a serum does have for most people or really target anything in particular. I personally don't like oils for a few reasons. One, I'm oily in my T-zone, and it's not that oils are bad for oily skin, but I just do not appreciate the feeling of an oil sitting on my skin. Also, I'd rather just moisturize. If I'm gonna do anything at the end of my routine that I feel really, really benefits my skin, rather than oil, I'll just be moisturizing. Maybe a moisturizer with some nice oils formulated into it. Oils can be beneficial, but for me personally, I've never used an oil that I love the feeling of or that I feel changes my skin enough in order for me to use it as a standalone product. I also prefer the hydration and the barrier repair that you can get from a lot of moisturizers. My skin just benefits from that a lot more. Don't get me wrong, oils have their benefits. I used to love using jojoba oil, those waxy esters, as like a top layer for when my skin was incredibly dehydrated and dry to stop that transepidermal water loss. But not every oil can do this. And despite what a lot of people think, an oil isn't always an occlusive layer, an unpenetratable layer. And as I mentioned, I've never found an oil that's so nicely formulated that I'm like, oh, I'm gonna use this. Of course, I use oil cleansers to remove sunscreen. If my skin's feeling a little bit stripped, a little bit irritated, I'll opt for an oil cleanser rather than using water on my face, but I do feel like they're a different category than just oils that you leave on your skin. They are. They're formulated to be cleansers, you know? The other thing I really hate about oils and a lot of brands that launch oils is the clean beauty kind of bullshit that comes behind it. The idea of them being pure and natural and quite literally squeezed from a plant, you know, and they shove a load of fucking rose petals in it and they're like heavily fragrance. We like fragrance here, don't worry. It's just, sometimes they're overbearing and it's usually just a load of essential oils as well. That doesn't always irritate skin, but the majority of the products that I've seen that are like, this is our something something oil elixir, and it's literally just a load of essential oils mixed in together that really have no benefits as ingredients. Not essential oils all in all, but you know, the particular ones that they tend to go for ones that smell nicer, do you know what I mean, rather than have benefits. It's just like, the marketing behind a lot of it has ruined it for me. The next one is micellar water. Again, a great first cleansing step, a great lazy cleanse, a great waterless cleanse, if that's your thing. And once they're applied to a cotton pad, they do such a good job at removing makeup, sunscreen, oils, all that kind of stuff. So we know that micellar water is like a cleansing water, right? It's not a toner. That uses micelles, which to put it extremely simply are like balls of surfactants to help trap oils and dirts and stuff, you know, whilst the outside of the balls help to dissolve all this crap. Let me Google, I'll Google a picture and I'll put it here. That'll help like show it better than I just described it. But the benefits are, of course, that they're super easy to use and also can be quite gentle on your skin as well. So why don't I use them? Purely because my skin doesn't like them. I have not found a micellar water that I can leave on my skin without my skin becoming itchy. I'm guaranteed to wake up the next day with dry and itchy skin, especially in areas where I'm most delicate. So like the corners of my eyes here, the corners of my nose here. I get almost like what feels like a heat rash. To me, like little dots that become really, really itchy and kind of warm. I, of course, went to the internet to find out why this was happening and just gathering loads of information from real skincare experts. I've come up with a few ideas as to why my skin might not get along with micellar water. The first point being that whilst micellar water can give you a really good cleanse, it may potentially not be as effective as just a general wash off cleanser or the two-step cleanser I usually do. When it comes to removing the day's debris and oils, excess oils, and very oily in my T-zone and sunscreen. I personally don't think it's that. I've seen quite a few really good micellar waters. I know a lot of people who will only cleanse with micellar waters and their skin is absolutely fine and does an amazing job at removing all the above. The next issue can be that the non-rinse aspect of micellar water, leaving surfactants on the skin, which bear in mind are designed to stay on your skin, could be causing me some irritation. I wasn't 100% sure how true those were. So whenever I have to question anything when it comes to skincare science, I always just go to Michelle Loudmuffin Beauty Science, her blog, to check out what she has to say. I find she has a really kind of like unbiased opinion on everything. Just tells you the cold, hard facts in a really simple way to understand. She actually mentions in her cleansing myth busting video that I'm looking at here, how to wash your face without a sink, that when it comes to rinsing away micellar water, it really depends on the product. Because of different ingredients and formulations, of course. Her personal favorite being Bioderma, which was specifically designed for those with sensitive skin and as a non-rinse micellar water. You know, and this is a micellar water that I see is very popular amongst dermatologists. Not like, you know, your Garnier 2-in-1 oil micellar water, you know, the kind of micellar waters I've tried. So I will be giving the Bioderma one a go, and if that fails, then I'm done. I'm done with micellar waters. But when it comes to cleansing waters, I actually really love this one by Coastal Citizen. I've been using this a lot recently. It does have some surfactants in, alongside green tea, oat kernel extract, and brightening and spot fighting ingredients like niacinamide as well. And I've been loving it. I actually wrote this script when I moved house back in September. And I've got here that I've been too busy because I've been moving house. And that was true back then. In the morning, I'd get up, wipe my face with this cleansing water, then get to unpacking. But I still just do it today. In the mornings, I will opt for like a quick cleansing water cleanse and then, you know, do whatever I have to do for the day, and it leaves my skin feeling refreshed. There's no tightness, there's no drying, there's no tingling in any corners. It feels incredibly, incredibly soft, gentle. So I need your help. I don't know if there's really any difference between a cleansing water and a micellar water. I know that in South Korea, micellar waters are called cleansing waters, but I wonder if it's purely a difference in the surfactants. Maybe I'm just, you know, get irritated by some leave-on ones. That's probably it, right? Anyway, mixing powders. I think we're very lucky in the sense that I don't think we're going to be seeing a lot of these anymore at all. There was a bit of a mixing trend at the beginning of last year. These are powdered actives that you mix into your wet products like toners and essences. And even serums. Now, we're not talking like exfoliating powders. I love the Key Soul Care exfoliating powder, you know, enzyme scrubs, love those. These are usually like vitamin C powders, but we also have niacinamide powders now that you're meant to like take a scoop of and mix in and basically play chemist at your vanity, which we know I don't enjoy doing. It takes up too much time and we aren't chemists. We've also seen powdered hyaluronic acid as well, which I kind of enjoy. I got these little squares that you kind of like, put your serum on it and it melts away, and they're kind of like pre-dosed for you. And I guess the idea is that you get a higher percentage of these actives in your ingredients, but I have really grown to dislike these and never really would I ever recommend them either. Here's another list of reasons why I don't like something. So number one, these are fiddly as fuck. They're so annoying. I know the ordinary niacinamide ones comes with this little spatula and you're meant to kind of like get the spoon and take the excess off the top, then pour it on your hand and mix it. And it's just, I don't want to be doing that. I don't want to be doing that when my hands are probably already covered in some product. They're a little bit slippery and it's too much faff. You know, like cupping your hand and then doing all this. It's not for me. The second point is that I don't like to play chemist. I don't want to be in my dressing room, mixing up all my products together to get like a product. I just want pre-made products done for me, thank you, with all the good stuff in them. Pretty much every step of the skincare routine has an active in nowadays, and it's just not needed. So I don't think we really need to be adding in these powders where they're not needed either, you know? The third point is that just because you're mixing in this powder into this product, it doesn't mean you're getting the full effects of the active of the powder. Like I said, not playing chemist, we don't know how to get an even spread of this ingredient within our skincare. We might not be reaping the full benefits. I know when I was using a niacinamide one, I would be rubbing that serum or that essence back on my face, and there'd just be balls of this product where it's kind of like clumped up, and it's just, it really wasn't for me. Final point is that I've seen a lot of people say they're a good money-saving option. So you buy these tubs of powder as your active instead of spending a lot of money on like a fancy serum with this ingredient in. So yeah, while they may last longer than a serum, in this powder form, you're not really getting the full effects of the ingredient, like I just said. Sorry, repeating myself, but it just feels like a waste of money. What I am interested in is there does seem to be a new trend of water-activated skincare. And this is designed not to try to be fancy and gimmicky, but as an eco-friendly alternative to a lot of skincare. Because obviously water within products weighs a lot. A lot of the time, water is a huge percentage of the formulation. So if you get your products as powder, you can then activate them with water. Shipping is a lot less expensive, a lot less heavy, you know, all that kind of stuff. I think it's a really good idea. And I think the difference here is that they're going to tell you, you know, exactly how much water you need to use. It'll be a tiny amount to activate, you know, a certain amount. So it'll be interesting to see how that is done in a way that you're going to get the full effect of the product. But I think that's a good idea. I've seen some that are like, sorry, I keep going on about this, but I've seen like a product, I can't remember if it was like a serum or something that's powder. And then on the bottle, it tells you how much water to fill it up with. And then you mix it yourself and you've got your product, which I guess having the exact measurement is the better option. I don't know. Let me know what you think. Let me know if you've seen this or not. So yeah, to me, it just seems like a whole waste of money and a gimmicky trend that thankfully didn't stick around. And I don't think we're going to see any more of it, to be honest with you. Let's talk about tinted sunscreen. I am giving up on finding a good tinted sunscreen. Disclaimer, I found some really good compact, like makeup, CC, cushions, balms, I don't know any of them, with factor 50 in that give good sunscreen coverage, a light makeup coverage as well, so they could be a good option. But tinted sunscreens, I feel like a lot of brands are putting out tinted sunscreens like, oh, here's the option for anyone with darker skin tones, you know, a bit of brown in there and it'll be fine. And with tinted sunscreens, there's always the same shade range. We are talking huge companies here as well who have the money to invest in a bigger shade range. They're all that light tan kind of color that whilst they'll be fine for people with white skin, if you go any darker, like even I struggle, I look a bit lighter on camera. You can't really see. The fact that I've got like an olive skin tone in this sofa, I'm trying to like show you my true colouring. So the fact that I have what is considered an olive skin tone, you can't really see it under all this lighting and I guess the colour correction I do, it's not that crazy olive though, is what I'm trying to say here. Like you'll look at my skin, you'll be like, oh, he's not white, but he kind of is, do you know what I mean? What I'm trying to say is that even me, as someone who is a very light skinned person of colour, I struggle to match these shade ranges of tinted sunscreen. So I feel like unless you are white or the exact color of the tinted sunscreen, these don't work for you. And isn't that the point of a tinted sunscreen, is to remove that white cast so people who don't have white skin can use this product absolutely fine? But the tint colors are terrible. And I always say, if these tinted sunscreens were a makeup foundation shade range, the brand would be getting called out all over the internet. We've already seen certain sunscreen brands come out with tinted sunscreens that don't have a big enough shade range. And their excuse was that they're multifunctional and you can pick a color that's roughly your skin color and it'll work. That's not the case. That's not the case at all. My brother, who's a makeup artist, pointed out that they have a whole selection for whiter and lighter skin, but then nothing for dark. So if the case was that you can just pick one and it'll kind of work with your skin, why have all these shade ranges for white skin to light tan and then nothing, like barely anything? Like, if that's the point, why did they need so many for that? You know, do you know what I mean? It's kind of like, if this was a makeup brand, they would have been cancelled. They would have had a whole controversy, you know? I just feel like if there was a zinc base sunscreen with a tint color that matched mine. So the Bliss something sunscreen is just about right. It still looks a little bit white on my skin, but I just don't like the formulation of that particular one. So I just wish there was a brand who did a full shade range of tinted SPF. You know what? I don't really care because, well, I do care about the ethics behind it, but I'm a chemical sunscreen kind of person. I think the idea of people constantly wanting the tinted sunscreen is because they have this idea in their head, or they've been told that a mineral sunscreen is better for people of color and black skin, or that chemical sunscreens are poisonous and toxic and you find them in your blood, all of which isn't true, being but myth busted time and time and time again. So if chemical sunscreens work for you, just use them. That's what I'm going to do now. I've given up trying to find a tinted sunscreen that actually matches my skin tone. But I do look forward to the day that a brand comes out with a full shade range of tints so that I can maybe try one, you know? I don't know. I've given up anyway. I don't care. Okay, let's talk about retinol. Retinol is, of course, like the queen of the skincare world. Like, everyone knows she works. They know what she does. Scientifically backed, all that kind of stuff. But for me, So I post about this on my Instagram, and it's not that I'm never going to use retinol again, but I'm just going to calm down being so diligent and strict about it and thinking, oh my God, I need to use it, otherwise what's the point? I have a love-hate relationship with retinol. It's down to my very mild, yet sometimes very noticeable rosacea. And my rosacea just seems to hate retinol in any form. Even when I buffer it with a moisturizer, it just doesn't seem to be loving it. And I didn't really get this link until I watched the Dr. Lee channel. And they mentioned how retinol could be a trigger for some people with retinol. Retinol with rosacea. I would start using retinol, be like, my skin absolutely loves this. And after a while, I just start flaring up. And that's the thing, is it's not a noticeable kind of like, oh, it's reacting. It would be when my rosacea does flare up, it's very obvious and much worse than it usually gets. Or I'd wake up the next morning incredibly flushed as well. Again, even if I buffered or used a small percentage. But there's so much talk online of retinol, of course, being the only true anti-aging product and how it must be in everyone's routine. To the point where I do an updated skincare routine video and people be like, what about your retinol? Where's your retinol? Why don't you use retinol? You should be using retinol. So, you know, you do feel that pressure to use it because everyone, you know, you should, I guess. That's what it feels like. And yes, it's true. It's great. You should use it if you can. But you know what? One day I looked at my mum and my nan, pretty much wrinkle-free. Like, I don't think I saw a single wrinkle on them until, like, they hit 60. I thought, you know what? I'm gonna be just fine. I'm gonna be fine. I got my Botox. I'm gonna be fine. Also, it's that thing, isn't it? Like, men tend to age well. Men have it so fucking easy that even when they get older, their beauty standards are like, oh, do what you want, you know? I've looked pretty much the same for 10 years now. I may be 2 stone heavier, but I pretty much looked the same. So I'm not in a desperate rush or panic to be like, I got to start using retinol now, it's time. Use it if you can. I have to admit, I wish I could just slap on retinol and be absolutely fine with it. I feel like I did have a really good tolerance to it for a while. Then my rosacea just like was like, you know what, you're not gonna use this anymore. So kind of annoying, but you know what, I'm just gonna stay hydrated, exfoliate, I don't know, get my Botox and just hope for the best. But there we go, those are products that I'm gonna stop using. I'm just gonna stop stressing out over. Let me know about yours in the comments down below. You can watch some more product reviews here and watch my new series here. There's only one, but there'll be a new one Sunday, and I'll see you over there.